Las telecomunicaciones en México son reguladas por la Secretaría de Comunicaciones y Transportes y por la Comisión Federal de Telecomunicaciones, o COFETEL. El mercado de comunicaciones en México está entre los más grandes de América, liberalizado en 1990 con la notable privatización del monopolio estatal de teléfonos de México, o Telmex. Desde entonces, nuevos operadores han entrado en el mercado, pero Telmex continúa siendo el mejor dominante. Los medios de comunicación no tienen que hacer propuestas para solucionar las problemáticas sociales. Ese no es su rol. Son medios, canales, vías, por los cuales es posible que la gente conozca las posibles soluciones a la problemática social propuestas por gobiernos, partidos políticos, asociaciones intermediadas o particulares. La propuesta consiste en que haya más diversidad de medios en las telecomunicaciones del país, ampliar el derecho de mayores concesiones al sector comunicativo para generar mayor diversidad en los medios de comunicación y que no exista un monopolio para que la sociedad pueda escoger qué ver dependiendo de su criterio y no solo ver TV Azteca y Televisa. La Asociación Mexicana de Derecho a la Información, que es la AMEDI, convocó el 5 y 6 de marzo del 2014 al Encuentro Nacional por la Diversidad y la Calidad en los Medios de Comunicación, que se llevó a cabo en el antiguo Hospital Concepción Beistegui, ubicado en la calle de Regina, en el corazón del casco histórico de la Ciudad de México. A grandes rasgos, este encuentro tuvo dos actividades fundamentales. Por un lado, la presentación y discusión de 119 ponencias de ciudadanos de 18 estados del país, en las que se expusieron una gama de diagnósticos y propuestas sobre el gran tema de los medios de comunicación y telecomunicaciones. Y por otro, la condensación de todas estas ideas y reflexión es un documento que al final del encuentro se hizo público y que es una agenda ciudadana para transformar la comunicación en México. Oligopolología en la comunicación. ¿Pero qué es la oligopolología? Es la concentración del poder o de la información en pocas manos, o más bien en pocas voces. También es la manipulación de la información y, por supuesto, en la expansión de la desinformación. Para todo esto debe de existir la democracia. ¿Pero qué es la democracia? Es un conjunto de derechos civiles, políticos y sociales atribuidos a los miembros de la comunidad. Este conjunto de derechos se traduce también en un conjunto de instituciones básicas, a saber, cargos públicos elegidos por los ciudadanos, elecciones libres, imparciales y frecuentes, además de la libertad de expresión de los ciudadanos, que es el derecho al voto, incluyendo la crítica de los cargos públicos, el régimen político y el orden socioeconómico, además de la ideología prevaleciente. Una democracia solo puede ser válida por la vía de la comunicación pública, abierta a todos y además acreditada desde la sociedad civil. Para esto, se presenta la unión entre democracia y oligopolio, y medios de comunicación en la crisis que enfrenta hoy la democracia generada por la privatización de lo público en la comunicación. El capitalismo ha generado que los bienes públicos sean objeto de una apropiación por parte de particulares, trayendo como consecuencia que las grandes corporaciones, que cuentan con el capital y los recursos humanos y tecnológicos, por lo que terminan siendo los que poseen y controlan la mayoría de los medios generados, así un oligopolio de los medios de comunicación. Un claro ejemplo de esto lo tenemos con Televisa y TV Azteca, que ellos son los que deciden qué es lo que tenemos que ver, si novelas, deportes, algo cultural, algo socioeconómico o algo divertido. Pongámonos a pensar. Ahora vamos a hablar del nuevo orden mundial económico a la información y la comunicación. ¿Tú sabes qué es eso? ¿Sabes que está manipulado todo eso? No te preocupes, ahorita te lo demuestro.
Release a CD like almost 10 years ago?
Yeah, I mean, I released a gospel record when I was 15 because I grew up in you know, a household where all I ever did was listen to gospel music, and my parents are both traveling ministers, and so I kind of sang about, you know, what was going on in my life at 15, and that's how I got introduced to the music industry. I swear I wanted to be like the Amy Grant of music.
Yeah.
But it didn't work out, and so I sold my soul to the devil.
Vegas. I think it's too late for praying. Hold up, her voice spoke to me and it slowly started saying,
bring the watch down to me, you'll make it better.
And how long will I live?
Eternal life and forever.
Or will I be the G that I was?
I make your life better than you can imagine. I'm even dreamed of. So relax yourself, let me take control. Close your eyes, my soul.
My eyes are closed.
Still out here doing your songs, you know, you're still on tour.
I do, but I don't take it for granted.
Why do you still do it? Why are you still out here?
Well, it goes back to the destiny thing. I mean, I made a bargain with it, you know, long time ago, and I'm holding up my end.
What was your bargain?
To get where I am now.
Should I ask who you made the bargain with?
with the chief chief commander
on this earth,
and in this earth, and then in the world we can't see.
Hello, Earth. I'm Alec Baldwin, TV star. You know, they say TV will rot your brain. That's absurd. TV only softens the brain like a ripe banana. To take it all the way, we've created Hulu. Hulu beams TV directly to your portable computing devices, giving you more of the cerebral gelatinizing shows you want, anytime, anywhere, for free.
I only hang out because I want your love.
Mushy and mush. And the best part is there's nothing you can do to stop it. I mean, what are you going to do, turn off your TV and your computer? Once your brains are reduced to a cottage cheese like mush, we'll scoop them out with a melon baller and gobble them right on up. Oops, I think I'm drooling a little. Because we're aliens. And that's how we roll. Hulu, an evil plot to destroy the world. Enjoy.
A través del cine, la moda y la música, por medio del entretenimiento, te dicen qué debes de comprar. Te dicen qué tienes que cantar. Te ponen mensajes directos y subliminales para aceptar el gobierno de la bestia. Te dicen subliminalmente a qué artista debes de imitar. Y te dicen que tomes el satanismo como algo bueno. Son los principales aspectos que se tocan en esta división de la maquinaria de entretener para tu adoctrinamiento. El grupo de entretenimiento no tiene nada de entretenimiento. Está creado para formarte social y espiritualmente, para que tu conciencia se cauterice y acepte el gobierno de Satanás. La música Illuminati sirve, por ejemplo, para inducirte a la depresión y a la desesperación, mientras que proporciona el pan y circo hipnotizante a los que siguen paralizados por el sistema melódico de Babilonia. Mediante sonidos repetitivos redundan en frases directas y subliminales en la melodía que habla sobre Satanás, normas de conducta de desobediencia, suicidio, agresión, etc. Los organizadores de un gobierno demoníaco tienen secuestrada la industria musical. El producto final de la industria musical Illuminati y quienes se encargarán de transmitir el mensaje de estos manipuladores satánicos son estas pobres marionetas. Pero el recurso de cine es la herramienta más eficaz para la transmisión de órdenes y lavado de cerebro. Pues además de utilizar el sonido, crea símbolos que van enfocados a reafirmar el control mental visualmente. Mientras que por otra vía se ataque el sentido del oído, todo este proceso trabaja a la misma vez. Mediante el cine se recauda millones de dólares mundialmente para las arcas satánicas de los Illuminatis. El cine crea patrones de conducta a seguir, destruye los valores humanos, disfraza la verdad, crea odios, nos inclina a descubrir el mundo satánico y a perdernos eternamente. La élite del mal, calladamente, controla actores, productores, directores y guionistas, pero que nunca mencionan públicamente su afiliación o el motivo por el cual hacen estas cosas. El número de películas sobre ocultismo que ha salido en los últimos 10 años debería darte una idea de lo que quieren enseñarte. Toma un momento de reflexión y piensa, ¿por qué hay tantas películas con este tema? ¿Por qué esa pérdida de sensibilidad entre la juventud hacia lo oculto y a la magia? Ahora te desafiamos a pensar sobre algo. ¿Por qué el 100% de los cantantes trabajan con patrones de conducta similares que no se salen de su cauce? Sencillamente, porque son marionetas del nuevo orden mundial. Ellos no se mandan solos. Han hecho un pacto bajo juramento de muerte de no revelar en público su afiliación. El que un artista pose con su dedo índice sobre sus labios significa el sometimiento del proyecto Illuminati sobre ellos. Observe este patrón de conducta sobre todos ellos.
television is a massive, massive mass hypnotist to the global mind. Mm. And what happens is, it is implanting a belief in reality by the minute, and then once we take on that belief implanted, when information enters the eyes, we edit it on the basis of that belief. And so what the global population is subjected to, suffering from, is actually literally mass hypnosis. And when we talk about people who kind of start to see things and see the manipulation they couldn't see before, what do we say about them? What do they say about themselves? They say, I woke up. Exactly what they've done. When people start to go, hey, I can see it now, it's like someone has gone along, like the hypnotist, and clicked their fingers, and it's like, oh, I can see it now. Mass hypnosis. And that is the greatest hypnotist on the planet, and that's the basis of why it was created.
A 49-year-old unidentified man went berserk last night.
Where does she get her view of the world?
Shotgun. 14 people are dead, including three.
Who will be her role models? Never been a better time to buy. What values will she have? Whose child is she? Yours or the network's? Take back your children. Turn off the TV.
When you start to research the subliminals in advertising and television, what staggers you is not, you know, what they do and what's there, but the scale of it. I mean, it's like our consciousness is being hit by an explosion of this stuff. Because, you see, this is another interesting point. Experiments have shown that about 1.5 seconds before the conscious mind decides to take action, move its arms or whatever, speak, 1.5 seconds before it consciously decides to do that, the electrical signals have begun in the brain to do it. For me, the conscious level is the experiencer and observer of reality, but the subconscious is the creator of it, the generator of it. And this is why the Illuminati want the subconscious mind through subliminals. What does subliminal mean? It means below threshold. It's below the threshold the conscious mind picks up, but the subconscious mind picks everything up like a sponge. And therefore they are planting these thoughts into the subconscious, which then filter down into the conscious, and we think we're having our own thoughts, when actually they're implanted thoughts done at a subliminal level.
¿Habrá regalos? Sí, te aseguro que siempre tendrás un lugar muy especial en mi corazón y en el nuevo orden mundial. 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 Y en el nuevo orden mundial.
¡Mandy! ¿Me darán regalos en el nuevo orden mundial? La señora Claus me lo dijo.
¿Cuál es la señal secreta que todo líder mundial conoce?
¿Señal secreta? Oh, bien, esa es fácil, es algo... ¿Como esto? Larga vida y...
Es ahora cuando te pido que analices si en verdad quieres ser famoso o no. Ahora, para no asustarlos tantos, hablemos de la determinación del interés económico e incidencia sobre el interés del Estado. Pero, ¿cuáles son los intereses económicos del Estado? Los intereses de un Estado son los recursos y o materias primas para la industria. ¿Y cuáles son estos recursos de la materia prima que les interesa al Estado? Son el petróleo, el carbono, los minerales preciosos como el oro, plata y todas esas piedras preciosas como el jade y el rubí, entre otras más. Además, en todo esto podemos incluir el adquirir nuevos territorios para expandir sus mercados, y el tener salidas hacia el mar para poder transportar sus productos. Es ahora que nos podemos preguntar, ¿será por esto que hay tanta guerra en el mundo y tantos conflictos entre países? No lo sé, piénsalo tú. Ahora les hablaremos de lo que es la crisis política y pública, y todo lo que nuestro gobierno hace para ellos poder salir de su crisis, sin tomar en cuenta las cosas que nos afectarían a nosotros como sociedad.
The American dream. There's a reason they call it a dream.
Who's there?
Cock-a-doodle-doo, pal.
No, 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 no! I don't have any more money! My job sucks right now, please! I'll have more money next month! You can't take my house!
Is that your signature?
Oh, okay, well, just help me work something out, okay? I mean, you said I'm a good credit guy, right? I mean, hey, wait! My dad is in there! No, don't take my dream! Oh, how did this happen? Hardman? Is that you?
It's been a long time since the fourth grade.
Is that a time machine?
There's no need to concern yourself with my standard accomplishments. Best get in. There's not much time.
I gotta go down to the bank and get my life back. They took everything!
Oh, bank ain't gonna help you now. Towel in the trunk. Extra set of balls, put them on, you're gonna need them.
You're gonna get my dream back?
No, pal, you are. I'm here to show you how.
Submitted for your approval. 1. First National Bank. What is a bank, you ask? A curious place where both space, time, and irony exist. And yet, don't.
Are you gonna be doing that the whole time?
Pay attention, pile. Exhibit A, those who have come to deposit and safely store their earned monies. Exhibit B, those who need to borrow said money for purposes unknown.
Hey, that's me!
Ergo, Exhibit C, the bank only has so much money in the vault to lend out to people such as you.
Hey! Hey, that's the guy! He took my house!
Really screwing my vibe here, pile. Space-time continuum. He can't hear you. Just let me narrate. Now, where was I?
So you see, by the time he got to you, pile, his bank was out of money.
But he gave me lots of money and charged me a lot of interest.
Yes, that's the only way banks make money, by making debt loans. Debt equals money, pile. Remember that. Debt equals money. The more loans they make, the more money they make.
But if they don't have any money, then where did my money come from?
You're gonna want to take a step back, Bob.
Whoa! No way!
Yes way. And that's nothing.
Hey, buddy! Need some money?
They didn't do that!
Oh, they did exactly that, pile. Remember, banks make money by making loans, by selling debt, even to bad credit risks.
Yo, have some money, dude. Just sign here.
Oh my gosh!
They called it free money.
Yeah, that's exactly what my loan guy told me. Free money!
But it ain't free. The worst part was offering money to people who don't even need it. People, pal, like you.
You're right. I didn't need him. I was happy here. I didn't need it! Why is he sad? He's making all that money.
Shh! He's thinking.
Now wait for it. Bingo.
See, the bank is loaned to everyone in town. But to make more money, they have to loan even more.
More? How much money do they need?
More.
Oh, what's that?
Behold, a black horse riding. Credit card.
I mean, it's gonna be okay. Everything's gonna be okay. What now?
Now, we're pie with all this money. We might as well party.
Oh, this is awesome! I needed to get my head clear. When I get back, I'm gonna straighten all this out. I just hope Dream is doing okay.
I'm going to get you, my pretty.
Yep, he is. I'm sure he is.
You put it on his tab. Little something for yourself. Wait.
You know, wait a second, Hartman. I just thought of something. If I got this money from the bank, and the bank got it from the Federal Reserve dump trucks...
Go on.
Then where does the Federal Reserve get their money?
Real nice time, ladies. Real nice. Now excuse me while I borrow from you.
Say, Hartman, why am I wearing a burglar bikini top?
Because no one is allowed inside the Fed. Not you, not me, no American citizen, no duly elected member of our Congress, not the Supreme Court.
Not the Supreme Court?
Not the Supreme Court. Not the Justice Department, not the CIA, DIA, FBI, ATF, ATE, NBC, not even G. O.D.
How come the government isn't allowed inside its own building?
Government? Pow, the Fed is a private bank owned by private stockholders. Do not let the name Federal fool you. This place is about as Federal Express.
A private bank? But private?
Shh. Best to keep your voice down, Pow.
This is Ethan, Federal Reserve.
Hey, Ethan. Bill here, First National.
Hi there, Bill. How are you?
Good, good. We're running a little low on money.
No problem. How much you need?
Oh, how does 20 million sound?
What?
Excellent. We'll ship it over first thing tomorrow.
Wait, he can just call up the Fed and ask for more money and they give him whatever they want?
No, pal. The Fed don't give the banks money. The Fed loans the banks money. The banks have to pay it back with interest. Now, come on, time to go.
Wait. I still don't understand. Where does the Fed get their money? I mean, if they're a private bank. You said they're a private bank, right? Okay, so who puts money into the Fed bank?
This is Mel, United States Mint.
Hi, ML. First National needs another 20 millis.
We're already running the presses full steam here, Ethan.
Gotta keep making loans. Gotta keep the money flowing.
All right, you're the Fed. Whatever you guys say, 20 million more by morning!
But I don't get it. What's so wrong about the Fed printing money?
Because it's unconstitutional, Pyle. Our treasury is supposed to create our money, but now the Fed controls the printing of America's money. Nobody gets a friggin' dollar that the Fed didn't print.
So?
They print the money, then they loan it to the government, then they charge the government interest, and then the government taxes you to pay for it. Wake up, Pyle!
God, I don't see what the big deal is.
You know, you're right, Pyle.
Wait a minute. Wait, I am?
Yeah. I forget how effective they are at keeping you ignorant.
Oh, that's okay. Hey, I'm not ignorant.
Do you even know what money is, Pa? In the long, long ago, people bought it. They traded things they had for things they wanted. I'll trade you my raspberries for that there pot pie.
I don't want your berries.
Come on, Pa. Those sweet berries.
They're not sweet, they're old, and I don't like berries.
Give me that pot pie!
No!
As you can see, this modern situation created some problems. Then one day, a goldsmith walked up and said...
Now, everybody thinks gold is valuable, so why doesn't everybody trade gold for things they need?
price was set for gold, and now it was very easy to conduct commerce because people could trade gold for all the things they needed.
Marvin! Wow, look at all my gold! Hey, stop them! That's my gold!
Damn, thieves!
Say there, Pyle. I've got a vault and some guards. I can keep your gold safe for you.
For a small fee.
Yeah, sure, that'd be awesome.
You see, Pyle, this is how the first bank made money.
There you go, Pyle. I owe you 100 gold coins.
Okay, great.
Come back anytime and redeem your gold when you want it. It'll be right here, in my vault.
Now you're holding the very first paper money, Pyle.
Wow, this is great. It all makes sense.
Oh, that's right. It was good, and everybody started using IOUs because everybody knew the IOU was as good as gold.
Wow, this candy is really a good price. One IOU. I'm getting some more for later. Hey, wait a minute. It was just one IOU. 10 IOUs for chocolate? You can't just raise prices like that.
Oh, the Candyman can.
Oh, the Candyman can.
Wait, that is just freaking wrong.
It's called inflation, Pyle. It makes your IOUs worth less and less until they are worth nothing. Less bang for the buck. Dollar ain't what it used to be.
But I worked hard and I baked all those pot pies. Now I have to work harder to make less? That's not fair.
Oh, if you think that's not fair, you're gonna love the next part.
What's he doing?
How do banks make money, Pyle?
By making more loans?
Oh, that's right. He's good. See, he prints more IOUs without any more gold, loans them out for interest, makes a pretty penny, and nobody is the wiser. Unless everybody wanted their gold back at the same time.
No. That's my gold.
Not anymore.
What are you talking about?
I'd like to redeem my IOUs, please. Thank you very much.
Hey! I want my gold back now! Thief! Thief!
I love the bank run. Bringing people together. See, they all found out he was stealing, made a run on the bank, and demanded their gold. But as you can see, they ain't no gold to get.
Hartman!
Don't worry, Pyle. Back in these times, vengeance will be yours. Three things in this world you don't do. Never mess with another man's woman. Never mess with another man's ego. And most importantly, you never mess with another man's money. Else, a man will mess with you.
My God! You hung him?
Yes, Pyle. Oh, we hung him. We hung him high. And do you know why?
Because he was a thief?
Because, Pyle, an evil invention was born. Man discovered how to turn worthless paper into gold. Thus was invented the ultimate machine to steal real money and enslave all the nations on Earth.
It's alive!
Oh, now, come on. You're just being dramatic. I mean, I lost my house, but...
What is that? Explain.
A nuclear power plant?
Mm-hmm.
Produces lots of electricity and little pollution. An invention for the good of humanity.
Okay, but what's this have to do with...
3, 2...
Holy atomic energy!
A discovery more powerful than anything man had yet conceived. It can be used for good or evil.
Now!
Unlike Einstein, the goldsmith's discovery has been kept a closely guarded secret. It was never intended for you to see. This discovery is called fractional reserve banking. In the wrong hands, it's more powerful than the nuclear bomb in its ability to completely and utterly destroy a nation who is subjected to its perversion.
No.
It is time we stop this evil secret and the men behind it.
You're being ridiculous.
Before America is destroyed forever. Believe it, Pyle.
No. I just want my dog back.
Damn it. That's it. I give up. Let them live in chains. No, Hartman. The tree of liberty must be refreshed from time to time with the blood of patriots and tyrants.
Thomas Jefferson?
Mr. President, how do I get him to understand? As we did, son, remain vigilant. Too many have hidden the truth, and the light of our liberty dims with every passing day. Quickly, take my horse. Show him.
Wait, show me what? Where are we going?
Stallion of Libertad! Right on the hoary wind! Oh, where are we? Battle of Waterloo! Hold on, we gotta get through! A money machine! There it is!
Hey, is that the same people?
Rich bankermen from Germany, flying under the banner of the Red Sheet. They finance both sides of the war. We must hurry! That's him, the Red Shield courier. Shoot him!
No, I'm not shooting anyone.
Damn it, Pop.
What?
He beat everyone back with the news of the war and told England that Napoleon won. The Red Shield bankers in London pretended that England was doomed and started selling their English stocks. The English went into a selling frenzy to get rid of worthless English money.
But the English won, right?
Of course they won, but it was a trick by Red Shield. They waited until the stocks plummeted to pennies and then bought England back for nearly nothing.
What? They did that? How?
When the English leaders found out, they had no choice but to give themselves over to the Red Shield. Their money was gone, and they were slaves to the Red Shield war debt. Since that time, the English have been paying their national taxes directly to the Red Shield private bankers. The people have no idea. But the bankers bragged about what they did to us, laughing at us all the way to the bank.
Why, it's the best business I've ever done. If I can control a nation's wealth, I care not who makes its laws.
Oh, is this what Jefferson wanted to show me?
No.
Look.
They're in America, too? The Red Shield banks are here, Pop. Seeking a way to conquer our American dream. The dream you have, Pop. The dream of free men. They tried to take over our country many times and failed because Jefferson and the Patriots vowed to stop the evil tyrants at all costs. By authority of eternal God, he would not let the bankers win again. To preserve our independence, we must not let our rulers load us with perpetual debt. We must make our choice between economy and liberty or profusion and servitude.
Wow.
I place economy among the first and most important of republican virtues, and public debt is the greatest of the dangers to be feared. It is incumbent on every generation to pay its own debts as it goes.
We must have a central bank to secure this country's finances.
If the American people ever allow private banks to control the issue of their money, first by inflation and then by deflation, the banks and corporations that will grow up around them will deprive the people of their property until their children will wake up homeless on the very continent their fathers conquered.
Jefferson, you're mad. This country will have a central bank.
Who's that?
America's first Secretary of Treasury.
Alexander Hamilton?
Not for long.
Aaron Burr, Thomas Jefferson's vice president. They didn't take too kindly to our first Sec Treasury. Sweet shot, Burr. The first attempt at a central bank only lasted 20 years and was shut down. But the bankers tried again against old Hickory President Andrew Jackson.
You are a den of vipers and thieves. I intend to rout you out, and by the eternal God, I will rout you out.
After surviving an assassination attempt, Jackson finally defeated the bank in 1836. When asked what was the greatest accomplishment in his life, old Hickory replied,
I killed the bank.
And those were his last words. I killed the bank. And with real money backed with real gold, our country experienced the greatest boom in any nation's history. Oh, it was beautiful. But the bankers, greedy for more power and wealth, were concocting their most ambitious plan yet to once and for all take control of the finances of the United States. In 1910, a secret meeting was held at a J.P. Morgan estate on Jekyll Island off the coast of Georgia. This meeting was so secretive, so concealed from government and public knowledge, that the 10 attendees used code names.
I am clearly the richest man, so I should be the one to run the super-secret central bank.
I own all the oil in America. I'm clearly richer than you will ever be, hula girl. I should run the super secret central bank. You're nothing compared to me, lube job. I shall run the secret bank.
Silence!
Supreme Master Leader, I didn't know you were gonna be here.
I'm not. Neither are you, dumbass.
Oh, yeah, right. He's so smart.
None of you shall run the bank. We have failed in the past because of openness. This time, the key to success is secrecy. The people must believe that they run the bank.
Yes, brilliant! A sneak attack. What's the plan?
We first create panic, then we show them the solution. With our man in office and well-planned timing, we will have our central bank. And so the people think it is theirs. We shall christen it Federal. The Federal Reserve.
They struck on December 23rd, 1913. When most of our Congress were at home eating fruitcake, these bastards, bankers, presented their treasonous act to their newly elected accomplice, Woodrow Wilson, who had fortuitously already agreed to sign it before he was even elected. Wait, the IRS? I thought we always had the IRS. No, Pyle. They did this to us, too. The Fed now has the exclusive power to print America's money. They loan this money to our banks and our government at interest, putting immediate debt on our own money, printing more and more, so each dollar they print becomes worth less than the one before. Merry Christmas.
What in the hell is that?
Bad pot is how our government now must pay back these debts to the Fed. Your taxes did not go to your government.
They don't?
It's the greatest theft in human history.
But, okay, I mean, I sort of get what you're saying, but it's also confusing. And really, Hartman, I don't see how it affects me at all. If I had more money, none of this would have happened. Hartman? $19.55? Wow, what are we doing here?
Oh, a little bit of shopping. Here, hold this. Gallon of gas? 23 cents. Postage stamp? 3 cents. Ounce of gold? $35. Hot baby.
Priceless.
Let's begin back.
Hey, Hartman! I need my car, man!
Oh, was that my gold chain?
Yeah, he'll be fine. Now, pile. Would you agree that you have the same exact things you had in 1955?
Yeah, one stamp, 1 gallon of gas, 1 ounce of gold, and one home. Wow, we just made a lot of money.
Run.
Hey!
Gotta pay your taxes. Bet it's nice to have made all that money.
Wait, that isn't fair. Now I actually have less money. I can't even go buy the things I just sold.
The IRS and the Fed's inflation work together, Pyle. They aren't just taxing gain, they are taxing their inflation. You are no richer than you were in 1955. Now, does that sound fair or American to you?
Yeah, but I mean, who doesn't hate taxes? I hate the IRS anyway.
Pyle, the higher they make the inflation, the more your money they take. It's thievery. You're not paying taxes on any more. You are paying taxes on the same, and now you have less. They take our property away right in front of our eyes, just like Thomas Jefferson said they would.
What's that?
Oh, they found him. Quick, my sword.
What sword?
You don't need your banking machine. I'll condemn you to die, damn it. Die! Hi, the Lanky Bogey on my nine. Take him at his knees.
For we are opposed around the world by a monolithic and ruthless conspiracy that relies primarily on covert means for expanding its sphere of influence.
What's happening? Where am I?
I believe perhaps you understand now, Pyle, but you are afraid.
JFK, Hartman, what does this have to do with my house and my dog?
Okay, that's enough. I want to go home now.
This is the last president to stand up to the Fed.
You must see.
On June 4, 1963, President Kennedy signed Executive Order 11110. This executive order empowered the U.S. Treasury to issue real money without the Fed. It would have worked. Kennedy's plan to dismantle the Federal Reserve machine had begun. 6 months later, John F. Kennedy went to Dallas and never returned.
No way. No way they could do that.
A new president, Lyndon Johnson, threw out Kennedy's order. And since JFK, no president has dared confront the secret powers behind the Federal Reserve. They consolidate bigger and bigger banks, print more and more money, accountable to no one, decimating our nation's wealth for the benefit of a few.
Why? Why do this? If they hurt us, it hurts the global bankers too.
No, Pyle. They are protected. They are too big to fail.
But I'm not.
Those sons of bitches!
Sons of bitches all. The day was cold. The wind sharp and strong. But we were determined. The bankers and their parasites had us vastly outnumbered, but their hubris made them weak. Not like us. Not like this band of immortals we have assembled. We have come to take back our...
Hardman? Is that...
my dog?
Oh, shit.
Then the inevitable. The money kings could ignore us no longer. They sent an emissary, a cog in their machine of greed, to bring about our submission. Hank Paulson.
Hardman, this is blasphemy. We own the corners of the earth. It is futile to challenge us.
Oh, I've seen that look before. That of a predator taking in the scent of its prey. Bold, fearless. The look of a free man.
You have come far, Hardman. Farther than most. Be smart now. Join us. We will bring you money, power, everything you want. You can be one of us. If you will kneel. This is. This is America!
Por último, les hablaré de los agentes políticos de la comunicación. Antes de hablar sobre lo que son los agentes políticos de la comunicación, debemos saber que las personas deben de considerarse como seres humanos y no como objetos, porque todos nosotros tenemos una dignidad infinita. ¿A qué me refiero con lo que acabo de mencionar? A que debe ser seleccionado muy coherentemente y especialmente lo que se presentará o explicará en los medios de comunicación. ¿Por qué digo esto? Porque con los contenidos que pongan en los medios de comunicación son con los que los habitantes de las poblaciones se identificarán y se dignificarán para esto y que tengamos un mejor modelo de vida. Para esto, veamos este último video seleccionado especialmente para ustedes.
Hoy los oaxaqueños podemos decir que las cosas están cambiando, porque así lo demuestran los hechos. En los últimos 3 años, ampliamos la infraestructura de salud estatal con 27 nuevas unidades médicas, incluyendo 4 hospitales comunitarios y 3 centros de salud con servicios ampliados, beneficiando a más de 250,000 de personas en regiones hasta ahora olvidadas. Entregamos 290 ambulancias terrestres y pusimos en operación 3 ambulancias aéreas que salvaron la vida a más de 600 personas. Hoy enfrentamos con éxito al cáncer de mama, cuyo número de casos se redujo 21%, y enfermedades como la oncocercosis y el paludismo se erradicaron definitivamente. Es cierto, aún nos falta mucho por hacer, pero ya hemos logrado bastante y juntos haremos más. Tercer informe de gobierno. Gabino Cue, generando bienestar.
Los medios de comunicación son los agentes de cambio en la democratización del acceso al patrimonio cultural, afirmó el presidente municipal de Oaxaca de Juárez, Luis Ugartechea Begué, al inaugurar el primer foro de periodistas en América Latina, realizado en el marco del 12º Congreso Mundial de la Organización de las Ciudades Patrimonio Mundial, el encuentro mundial que convoca a más de 250 representantes de todo el mundo. Ante el profesor titular Cátedra UNESCO en Patrimonio Cultural de la Universidad de Laval, Quebec, Canadá, Charles Momoni, el secretario general y la secretaria general adjunta de la Organización de Ciudades Patrimonio Mundial, Denis Ricard y Lee Minaidis, respectivamente, precisó que las y los comunicadores, a través de una constante labor informativa sobre conocimientos y derechos, hacen posible que sus lectores, escuchas y televidentes entren en contacto directo con los bienes y servicios culturales.
Siempre hemos sostenido que debemos conocer el patrimonio cultural y alentar la conciencia de que rescatarlo, preservarlo y difundirlo es proteger las culturas y las diversas identidades, lo que nos posibilita asegurar la transmisión de ese legado a las próximas generaciones en un contexto de desarrollo sustentable. Para que el conocimiento y la defensa de la herencia común sea una acción permanente de la mayoría de los pueblos, es imprescindible la plena democratización del acceso al patrimonio cultural. Y los grandes agentes que ayudan a potenciar este cambio son ustedes, son los medios de comunicación y sus trabajadores, que a través de una constante labor informativa sobre conocimientos y derechos, hacen posible que sus lectores y escuchas y televidentes entren en contacto directo con los bienes y servicios culturales. Esta verdadera comunicación participativa debe convertirse en referente para el intercambio, el diálogo multicultural, la opinión diversa y la aproximación directa de la mayoría de la población al patrimonio cultural. Con la realización de este foro de periodistas, organizado por la OCPN y bajo la coordinación académica de la Universidad Laval y operativa del Honorable Ayuntamiento de Oaxaca de Juárez, pretendemos coadyuvar con los medios de comunicación en el fortalecimiento de sus políticas editoriales y agendas comunicativas para contribuir al conocimiento, difusión y conservación del patrimonio cultural.
Por su parte, el secretario general de la OCPM, Dennis Rickard, explicó que las ciudades consideradas Patrimonio Mundial de la UNESCO son un ejemplo de desarrollo sustentable, aunque dijo, hace falta concienciar en sus habitantes sobre el valor único de lo que implica este nombramiento. En su intervención, la secretaria general adjunta, Lee Minaidis, explicó que la Organización de las Ciudades del Patrimonio Mundial fue creada para ayudar a las ciudades inscritas en la lista del Patrimonio Mundial a adaptar y mejorar los métodos de conservación, así como para promover la gestión más eficaz de su patrimonio a través de la cooperación y el intercambio de información y la experiencia. El profesor titular de la Cátedra UNESCO en Patrimonio Cultural y coordinador académico del foro, Charles Mouhouni, indicó que esta plataforma ofrece la oportunidad de revisar las razones por las cuales Oaxaca fue inscrita en la lista de Patrimonio Mundial de la UNESCO. En el foro de periodistas participaron comunicadores, colaboradores de comunicación social de diversas dependencias públicas, nacionales y estatales, así como integrantes de asociaciones y sindicatos de periodistas y asociaciones académicas y universitarias. Con imágenes de Graciano Gómez, información de Vicente de la Cruz Arrazola, Agencia Cuadratín.
That summertime.